Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I am Dr. Muhammad Adnan, working as Assistant Professor in the Department of Physics, Kohat University of Science and Technology. I welcome you to the course PHY352, Nuclear Physics 1. Today, it is the 22nd lecture of this course, and the topic is Fermi-Gas model. The outline of this lecture is, it is based on the Fermi-Gas model, that is, the student will understand the Fermi-Gas model for understanding the nucleon-nucleon interaction. In my last lecture, I told you that since the nature of the nuclear force, or we can say the mathematical description and the associated potential with the nucleon-nuclear interaction is not straightforward. So we have these various models based on various description to analyze the properties of the nuclei, or we can say the nature of the nuclear force. So in this part, we'll be discussing the Fermi-Gas model. In this course, we are following the book Introductory Nuclear Physics by Kenneth S. Crane, 3rd edition. In this lecture, I have taken some of the illustrations from this book. Now, this Fermi-Gas model is sometimes called the statistical model or the uniform particle model. It was proposed by E. Wagner in 1937. If you remember, I told you in the last lecture, which was about the introductory remarks regarding the nuclear model, that this Fermi-Gas model is similar to the free electron model that you have discussed in the solid state physics. So it is assumed that as a result of very strong interaction between nucleons, the motion of the individual nucleons cannot be considered in detail, but be treated statistically. So, as I told you that we'll be treating the nucleons as fermions following the Fermi-Dirac statistics. That is, this Fermi-Gas model describes the nucleon-nucleon interaction statistically based on the Fermi-Dirac statistics. So, we will just outline those important results regarding the Fermi-Dirac statistics that we will be applying on the nucleon-nucleon interaction. And particularly in this lecture, we'll be trying to see the kinetic energy associated with the nucleons in the center of mass system. Of course, since we are treating the relative separations between the nucleon and nucleon, if you remember the deuteron lecture, so there we have used the reduced mass, center of mass concept. So here we'll be trying to see the nature or the strength of the nuclear potential that we have discussed for the deuteron, especially following the two-dimensional potential well. And there we have concluded that it was a strong potential. V naught was around 35-36 mega electron volt. So we'll see how the kinetic energy of these nucleons, and then why generally the binding energy per nucleon is around 8 MeV. Once we are talking about weakly bound system, that is deuteron, so there it was around 1.1, since in deuteron we have only two nucleons. So there the binding energy is somehow constant, so we'll see the relationship at the end, the relation, or we can say the strength of the potential energy, kinetic energy, and the binding energy, how they are linked based on statistical approach. So the mathematical treatment of nuclei in this model resembles the discussion of the free electron gas in a solid state physics, where electron moves quasi freely in a background of the positively charged ions. Since this was already discussed that they are similar to the fermions in the free electron gas based on the interaction between the nucleons and the electrons. So it is almost similar. We'll be treating the nucleons to be quasi freely moving inside the nuclei so that we just discuss the energies of these various nucleons. So, as I told you, we'll be interested in the magnitude of the energies. So, the description of the Fermi momentum and energy in the Fermi-Dirac statistics are already clear to you, but we'll be just summarizing it. The theoretical concept of the Fermi gas can be applied to system of weakly interacting fermions. So we are assuming, as I told you, the nucleons to be weakly interacting fermions, since proton and neutron both are fermions. Thus, nucleons are considered as moving quasi freely within the nuclear volume, so that the binding potential is generated by all the nucleons, since we are treating the nucleons now statistically. Those neutrons and protons are distinguishable fermions and are therefore situated in two separate potential wells. So, we will be treating these fermions in two different potential wells, since we are trying to understand the nature of this V naught, or you can say the strength, why this is so much. And then if you see this, these are the potential well, you can say, while describing it through the Fermi-Dirac statistics. So this is the various levels for the neutrons, and these are the identical levels for the protons. But one can see that the well for the protons are not that deep as compared to the well for the neutron, because of this Coulombic force between. So this Coulombic force, since opposes the nuclear interaction in some particular range, as we have already told in the previous lecture, that this nuclear force itself is repulsive in some small scale, but in generally we can say that the nuclear force is a short range attractive force, so that the Coulombic force opposes. So for this well, that is not that much deep compared to the well of the neutrons. So these are the identical but somehow lesser deeper for the proton and then for the neutron. So these are the various labels, as I told you, that we'll be trying to analyze the potential, since in quantum physics the potential energy is described through potential. So this V naught is like, we can say that this is the potential energy associated with the system through which this is bound, and then the kinetic energy, and then the binding energy. So we'll be trying to analyze these potential wells on the basis of these three energies based on the Fermi gas model. So in this bullet, I told you that there are two different separated potential well. As for a very simple approximation, these nuclear potential wells are considered as rectangular. If you remember the deuteron lecture, for the simplest situation, I told you that this V, the potential associated with the nucleon-nuclear interaction, is somehow radial. That is, the energy is determined only by the radial part, or spherically symmetric. So that assumption is already discussed in my previous lecture. Each state is filled with two nucleons of the same type with different spin orientation, following the Pauli exclusion principle. As I told you, if these particles are obeying the Fermi-Dirac statistics, so means they are fermions, so they are following the Pauli exclusion principle. So they are identical, so they cannot have the same set of four quantum numbers. So they are identical nucleon to nucleon, but they have their different spin orientation. The two potentials, though, have slightly different shapes, mainly because of the Coulombic part. That part is already discussed. As I told you, this Coulombic force is there for the proton-proton, so that's why this is not that deep compared to the well for the neutrons, assuming Fermi gas model. Also, the well for the proton is less deep because of the Coulombic potential by an amount EC, that is the Coulombic energy. Since I told you this potential V naught is potential energy, so this energy is somehow lesser for the proton well. Or we can say the depth of this well is somehow smaller than this one, or this V naught is somehow lesser than this one because of the Coulombic force. And of course, the 1 over r dependence of the Coulomb potential extends the range, and the last bound nucleons have the same, the equal energy, and the zero coincides as shown here. Now, based on these description that we have taken from the free electron model, or we can say the Fermi-Dirac distribution, which is valid for weakly interacting fermions. So now we'll be trying to discuss the various aspects regarding the nucleon, since we are applying this model on the nucleons. So the first aspect, that is neglecting spin and states degeneracy, the number of state of proton and neutron within the spherical nuclear volume V is given by. As I told you, we have assumed the rectangular well, that is the for the spherical nucleus, that is the potential is spherically symmetric within this volume. And also, if you remember where we were discussing the deuteron nuclei, so there again we have considered that potential to be central potential, that is the spin, or we can say the non-central part is neglected just for the simplicity of understanding the basic, or we can say the fundamental aspects of the nuclear potential. So you know that in Fermi-Dirac distribution, the density of states are, we can say the density, these states are the energy states, of course. So this is the volume. So density of state means number of states per unit volume. So this is the standard expression in the Fermi-Dirac. You can go through your statistical mechanics course how one can write the number of states. You can make it per volume so that you can study this in the density of state topic. So there you can understand this is the momentum of those energy states. For the low excitation energy, that is the nucleus is in its ground state called the T is equal to zero limit, the lowest states will be filled pairwise up to maximum momentum called the Fermi momentum or PF or the Fermi level. So, and also you know that the top most fill levels are the Fermi levels. The number of these states follow from the integrating the above equation. So as I told you, these are the density of states. So if we integrate this with respect to this momentum, so that we can find out the number of states. So this n represents the number of states. So that if we just follow the simple step, since this is not part of this course, since we'll be just using the final versions and discussing the nature of the nuclear potential. So this is the number of states following the Fermi-Dirac distribution while treating the nucleon-nucleon interaction weak, so that it lies within the assumptions made for the Fermi-Dirac distribution. Now, since each state, as we have discussed on the previous slide, that we have two wells, so each can be filled with two nucleons of the same type, then the number of neutrons and protons are this. So if we just write this number by N and this by Z, so this is just the same thing, but writing it for the neutron and proton separately. So these are the results. We need to take this directly, but you know from where these expression come. So these expression arises from the description of the Fermi-Dirac model. So we need these two expression for the proton and neutron in those energy state, where this PF for the neutron and proton are the Fermi moment of the neutron and proton respectively. So these are the number we need to find out using the previous knowledge that we have in this course, that is this volume V is 4 over 3 pi r cube for the spherical nuclei, and we know that r is equal to r naught a to the power 1 over 3, so that this volume can be expressed in terms of r naught, and the r naught value is 1.2 femtometer. We obtain for neutron and proton equal to a by 2, that is almost half. This is not always the case, since if you remember, we have discussed these numbers, but in this course, or we can say in this lecture, we are treating that the proton and neutron in a given state are equal at a by 2, and equal radius for the two separate potential wells of the proton and neutron, a Fermi momentum can be expressed like this. So if you see this, if we write this N is equal to a by 2, and this Z is equal to a by 2 here, and then if we use this volume for the spherical nucleus 4 over 3 pi r naught cube into a here, so that these h cuts and these pi values are given, so we can say constant, so one can find out the value of these momenta. So once we have the momentum, the value of the momentum for these states, then we can find out the kinetic energy, and then we can compare the two energy, as I told you that that was the aim of this lecture. So assuming that that nuclei is having equal number of proton and equal number of neutron, that is N is equal to Z is equal to a by 2, so that the momentum can be find out, and that is around 250 mega electron volt per C. Now, as I told you, the corresponding Fermi kinetic energy, which is the energy of the highest occupied nucleons level, that is the Fermi levels. So the kinetic energy is around 33 mega electron volt. So if you remember the deuteron nuclei, so there the potential V naught, or the interaction potential, or the potential energy between two nucleon was around 35-36 mega electron volt. So here we have discussed the nucleon-nuclear interaction as weak interaction, and we have used the Fermi model that is similar to the free electron gas in solid state, and there from these well-known expression, we calculated the momentum and then the corresponding Fermi energy. So the kinetic energy is also of the order of, we can say, the potential energy, that was around 35-36 mega electron volt. So, and if you remember in this lecture, I told you that this M is the nucleon mass, and this is M is equal to MP. So if you remember, the difference binding energy between the edge of the potential well and the Fermi level is rather constant for different nuclei and is equal to the average binding energy per nucleon, since the kinetic energy and the potential energy, and then we have the binding energy. Since this is a more or less constant once we are talking about typical nuclei, so hence the depth of the potential well V naught is approximately independent of A. That is, we have discussed the deuteron nuclei, and there we have modeled the interaction potential of the nucleon, that is proton and neutron, through their two-dimensional potential well, and somehow we have approximate that potential, that is neglecting the non-central part, and also we have taken the spherically symmetric potential, and there through that transcendental equation we have find out that V naught, which is the potential associated with the interaction between nucleons, was around 35-36 mega electron volt. And hence, if you hear, we have concluded that this potential generally is independent of the number of nucleon, that is whether we are discussing two nucleon system or n nucleon system, that potential will always be around 35-36 mega electron volt approximately. So that potential is equal to the energy, the Fermi energy, plus the binding energy. So that was around, roughly speaking, around 40 mega electron volt. So there we have managed to describe that potential for the deuteron, that was around 36 mega electron volt. And we have discussed that the binding energy is small, that is the weakly bound system, the binding energy in that case, it was 2.2 mega electron volt. So one can conclude that, which shows that the kinetic and potential energies of the nucleons are of the same order. That is, in this sense, nucleons are rather weakly bound in the nucleons, and that is the fundamental assumption for the Fermi gas model, and that one can have that the binding energy is somehow constant, whether we are discussing a small system, nuclei, or a large system. So somehow this potential and the kinetic energy, they are almost of the same order, and then the binding energy per nucleon is around 7 to 8 mega electron volt. So with this conclusion, that one can approximate the nature of the nucleon-nucleon interaction using the statistical description based on this Fermi gas model, and one can analyze the strength of the nucleon-nucleon interaction rather in a simplified manner. So with this, I thank you for your time.